How to Be a Dad. The Ultimate Guide to Pregnancy, Birth and Dirty Nappies. Written by Dr. Oscar Duke. Read by Oscar and Ray Duke. Hi, I'm Dr. Oscar Duke. Just before we get started, please remember that while this book contains a lot of medical advice, it should never be a substitute for diagnosis, advice or treatment given by your own doctor. Introduction. I've spent years looking after pregnant women and supporting parents as they welcome their new arrivals into the world. Watching as they scramble to care for them in the best possible way, without dropping them, allowing them to vomit on unsuspecting friends, or cover too many carpets with bright yellow poo. As a doctor, you might think that after all the hours of studying, night shifts and exams I'd taken, that I'd know it all. But really, I felt like a fraud. Deep down, I knew that there'd be no substitute for the first-hand experience of becoming a dad myself, and I wasn't wrong. Within a week of having my daughter, I'd learned more useful and practical information about how to care for a baby than any textbook, on-call shift or antenatal class could ever have taught me. The greatest surprise for me was the vast range of different emotions I felt as the process of becoming a parent so quickly unfolded before my eyes. None of the books I'd come across addressed how a dad might feel as he discovered that he was having a baby, or stood by watching as his child's head appeared from the entrance of a vagina. Some of these are elating, some terrifying, and others just mind-blowing. But with alarmingly increasing rates of postnatal anxiety and depression amongst new dads, I felt these conversations needed to be had. Understanding the facts gives you some armour, but I hope that by sharing my personal experience and those of many of my patients, this book will equip you mentally to cope with all that lies ahead as you discover, in your own way, how to be a dad. Chapter 1. Balls, where it all begins. From the doctor. Ever since you burst onto the planet, these two little, or not so little, reservoirs of life have been there. Often in the way, liable to painful injury, and hidden away from your mum at the earliest sight of a pubic hair, these potential life-givers, which, if you've listened to health advice, you might have occasionally checked for lumps and bumps, are now at the forefront of your mind. You may have picked up this book because yours have just excelled themselves in their child-making class, or simply because you're wondering about their potential for future success. After years of getting it on before you get it off, or inquiring cautiously as to whether your partner has remembered her particular form of contraception that day, now the game plan has changed. If you're anything like me, the fear of catching chlamydia or another sexually transmitted infection has always paled into insignificance beside the prospect of an unintentional pregnancy. We all know that most infections can either be cured or treated highly effectively, but the thought of becoming a dad is quite simply on another level. This is a game changer that begins the very moment your balls do their life-creating thing for the first time. Women have libraries of books, blogs, podcasts and magazines that devote billions of pages to the experience of conception, pregnancy and childbirth. By writing this, I in no way intended to undermine the huge physical, psychological and hormonal journey that any pregnant woman goes through. However, I hope that this book, written as it is by a doctor who has cast aside the condoms and ridden the roller coaster to becoming a dad, will go some way towards answering those man questions that never quite make it to pubs, locker rooms, water coolers, or any other locations where men might find themselves having meaningful chats. Although, let's face it, getting men to talk about anything personal is almost as difficult as it is to get an egg fertilised by a sperm. Hopefully, reading this will give you a head start when it comes to understanding what the hell is going on now that a baby is on the horizon. Think of it as a papery man hug that can guide you through what is a potentially treacherous world of terminology, hormones, social change, sleep deprivation, and finally, dirty nappies with tiny feet attached. Learning the basics. In my fourth year at medical school, after years of studying biochemistry, hearts, lungs, bones, and all the organs in between, the syllabus finally turned to obstetrics, the branch of medicine responsible for helping women to grow babies and bring them into the world. I really couldn't have been less interested in the subject. Granted, this was before the days of one born every minute being on TV, So just seeing a freshly birthed baby spring through its mother's legs or being removed from her open abdomen was pretty novel. But the thought of having a child of my own was completely off my radar. In the first week, we underwent the most bizarre and by now legendary element of medical training to date, well beyond the realms of dissecting preserved body parts. We were split into groups to meet the gynecology teaching associates, a pair of delightful middle-aged women who taught us by live demonstration on each other how to perform a vaginal examination and how to use the speculum, the notorious plastic duck-beaked shaped implement dreaded by women having smear tests, to look through the vagina to see the cervix, the gateway to the womb or uterus. One by one, we joined a queue to practice while the lady in question gave feedback, the content of which is etched on my mind forever. "Very good, now just take your thumb off my clitoris," or "perfectly done, just try not to catch a pubic hair next time." Well, how else were we supposed to learn? The cervix is going to feature heavily in this story. You might have felt it if you've ever put anything with sensation inside a vagina. It feels a bit like the tip of your nose and looks like a very small donut, round with a tiny hole in the middle. Some say it actually just looks like the head of a penis staring at you from the back of the vagina. Several years later, as a fully qualified doctor working in a sexual health clinic, I began my first professional search for a woman's cervix. As the woman climbed onto the examination couch, she asked if it mattered that she was on her period. It didn't, so I politely reassured her that there was no need to worry. This was true for her, but not for me. A tiny bit of my inner man cringed. I had a flashback to GCSE biology and those complicated graphs you might remember showing the hormonal changes of the menstrual cycle. But my real fear was of the period blood itself. And stick with me here. As soon as I saw it, my perception changed forever. This was not the stuff of horror films. This blood was a gentle trickle, neatly oozing from the opening of the cervix and flowing into the vagina. A remarkable natural phenomenon that's a sign of fertility and of life to come. Just for a moment, I felt like David Attenborough, marvelling over the natural world. I briefly contemplated a breathy voiceover, but remembered myself, took a quick swab, and withdrew the speculum. I had escaped unharmed. The baby making. So after years of irrational period man fear and the relief that contraception had yet again done us proud, my attention was now turned to a completely opposite aim, baby making. A world where the sight of vaginal blood is more unwanted than ever before. You may have arrived here after battling through months of ovulation calculators, period apps and militant sex schedules. Perhaps you finally succeeded with some help from a fertility clinic, or have accidentally got somebody pregnant and are now wondering, with shrinking testicles, what might lie ahead. A few generations back, men provided the sperm, paid for all the baby gear and went straight back out to work. Before that, and you've seen the period dramas, men just jumped on, did the business until they'd satisfied themselves and moved on. In every way that it's right relationships have changed and developed since those days, it's also right that men, indeed dads, should expect to understand and fully participate in the making, growing, birthing and parenting of their children. Obviously, you can uncross your legs, you're not going to hurt downstairs, but being an informed, involved father can improve pregnancy outcomes as well as childhood behaviour and relationships for years to come. And no, this doesn't just depend on whether or not you do the washing up. Modern relationships are, luckily for men and women, farting in the face of stereotype. From stay-at-home dads to same-sex parents, industry-leading mums to full-time mannies, never has the role of dad been so varied. Whichever one you find yourself contemplating, fatherhood will bring its own huge rewards and challenges. You may be asking yourself, when is the right time to have a child? How will it affect my life, relationship, job, or family? Can I afford it? These are all very sensible questions, which certainly ran through my mind when I finally agreed to let the sperm flow freely in the rampant, you should have seen the schedule, quest for fatherhood. My wife had wanted children since time began, and this feeling had certainly intensified since we'd married. The best men even mentioned the prospect of children in their speech. But what did I want? I knew I did one day want to be a dad, but when? Is now right, I thought. Am I grown up enough? I was recently asked for ID when I was trying to buy a bottle of Sauvignon in the supermarket. I'm 31, I replied. But you look so young, said the sales assistant, as if this was some sort of compliment, before he refused to accept my NHS ID card, which clearly stated that I was a doctor, as evidence for me meeting the legal drinking age. Medically, we now know that a man's sperm deteriorates in quality as he ages, which may bring with it an increased risk of conditions such as autism in your child. It's not exactly the ticking time bomb of female fertility, but worth a thought as research reveals more. In reality, though, there probably never is a perfect time. In my situation, a quick check of the job status revealed I was likely to be employed for a while. Our relationship seemed wonderful, and the balls were producing something, but who knew whether it contained anything worthwhile? I obviously can't look into the unique situation of every potential dad-to-be in this tome, but whatever your concerns are, rest assured there is always help and advice available. In my case, I had a fear of passing on the genetic condition albinism, a pigment disorder resulting in white hair and skin and a severe visual impairment that I live with every day. Whilst it's not a life-limiting condition, it's still pretty undesirable. I might have felt differently about it if somebody had told me they were casting people with albinism in the Da Vinci Code, or that Harry Potter's nemesis Draco Malfoy was in fact ridiculously blonde. But I knew I'd prefer to pass some of my better qualities onto a child, and not curse them with a life of peering at screens and being unable to work out which bus is about to run them over. So I went to see a geneticist. After a painstaking wait, my inbuilt error was finally identified. A tiny but significant faulty gene in my DNA. Talk about scrutinising yourself. I was told that I would pass the gene to all of my offspring, horrible word, but they'd only have albinism if my wife carried the gene too. She's not albino, we're not related as far as we know, so we decided to leave it to chance. Unnervingly though, I realised I'd just bought a lottery ticket, so I must in some way believe in small chances winning through. As I have recently made a TV documentary about the murder and mutilation of people with albinism in East Africa, my perceptions have somewhat changed. Albinism is certainly not ideal, but worse things could happen. I'll uncover the mysteries of routine genetic screening during pregnancy later in the book. This brings us neatly back to my balls, or yours for that matter. Exactly half of your genetic makeup is neatly packaged into each tiny sperm. All being well, during ejaculation, more than 39 million sperm suspended in nutrient-rich seminal fluid leave your penis, travelling at over 20 miles an hour. The volume varies, but on average 3.7 mils, approximately 3/4 of a teaspoon, of the little swimmers head out on a challenging, perilous journey that few survive. Fortunately for us men, the chances of surviving the journey ahead are far greater. So ready the balls and let the voyage to fatherhood begin. From the dad. Being a doctor allows me to explain all the factual elements of this exciting journey into fatherhood in a way that I hope is both interesting and understandable to someone with no medical training. But the science, procedures and jargon that I've picked up throughout my training and career are only a tiny fraction of what I've had to learn as I've become a dad myself. So I've added a From the Dad section to each chapter, providing an insight into how I, and the hundreds of dads that I've met both professionally and personally, think and feel as we embark on one of life's biggest and greatest challenges. It's an emotional process, so you may as well hear it, as it is, from guys who've been there before. No two men will ever have the same experience, and yours will be completely unique too. If you're at the start of the adventure, however you do or don't define your gender or sexuality, and in whatever capacity you've come to be considering fatherhood, I hope this book will go some way towards facilitating and enhancing your experience. What women want. While dads can take many roles along this journey, so far the one thing we can't do is grow and carry a baby. But you can be an invaluable source of support for your partner. So, at the end of each chapter, we'll discuss the do's and don'ts for dads-to-be from a survey of pregnant women, telling you, in their own words, how you can help and ease the burden for your partner. It seems only fair. And who better to explain it than my wife, Ray? Chapter 2. Uterus. From Fertility to Fetus. From the Doctor. Maybe years of planning have now resulted in your partner thinking she's pregnant, or perhaps you've received a terrifying phone call from a woman telling you she's missed her period. Either way, stay calm, breathe, and get a pregnancy test to confirm things officially. Your partner can buy a home testing kit from any pharmacy or supermarket, or go to the doctor or a sexual health clinic. When your super swimming sperm combine with its now inseparable egg friend, it makes its way down a fallopian tube, the fine pipes that connect the ovaries to the uterus, and embeds itself in the wall of the uterus. As it develops, the placenta, the alien-like object that acts as a buffet for the baby to provide a constant supply of perfectly prepared food throughout pregnancy, begins to form and implants itself into the wall of the uterus and releases a hormone called human chorionic gonadotropin, or HCG, into the bloodstream. Blood is filtered by the kidneys and the HCG passes into the woman's urine. This so-called implantation can happen any time between 6 and 12 days after an egg is released by the ovaries, ovulation. Whatever the promises made on the packaging, pregnancy test kits all work in pretty much the same way. Whether your partner collects the urine in a pot and dips the stick into it, or pees directly onto the stick, the presence of HCG is what gives the positive result. Different kits claim to detect pregnancy at different stages. Some even guarantee to pick it up a week before a missed period. This is all marvellous stuff. If you're anything like other expectant parents, you'll probably have spent a small fortune on overpriced test kits before you're satisfied that the thin blue positive lines are not just a figment of your imagination. However, even a faint line means the test is positive and confirms that the bun is well and truly in the oven. If the test isn't positive and there's still no sign of that period, give it a few days and try again. Most kits come with at least 2 test sticks anyway. Before you spread the news, instead of rushing out to shout from the rooftops or fill social media with images of your wee-soaked test sticks, it's worth spending a few miserable minutes thinking about some of the possible things that can go wrong in the early stages of pregnancy. Occasionally, the sperm-egg combo fails to implant in the correct place in the uterus and instead gets stuck outside of the uterus, for example, in a fallopian tube. This is known as an ectopic pregnancy, and not only will the baby sadly not survive, but if unspotted, it can pose a huge danger to your partner, so it needs to be removed. This can either be done by taking medication or by undergoing a surgical procedure. Only about 12,000 ectopic pregnancies occur in the UK each year. Signs to look out for include vaginal bleeding, tummy pain, or weirdly, pain in the tip of the shoulder. To confuse things further, a small amount of bleeding can occur normally during implantation, even when everything's going well. So, to be on the safe side, discuss any bleeding or tummy pain that occurs in pregnancy with your doctor or midwife, who can arrange a scan if they're concerned to see exactly what's going on in there. While we're talking about bleeding in early pregnancy, it's worth remembering that this could be a sign of a miscarriage. About 1 in 4 known pregnancies end in miscarriage, but it's thought many more have occurred before a woman even realises she's pregnant. Miscarriage is often the result of an underlying genetic problem with the growing baby, and most, around 85%, occur within the first 12 weeks of pregnancy. Undoubtedly, this is a very difficult and upsetting experience for both you and your partner to find yourselves in. But remember, there is a lot of support available. Importantly, most miscarriages are one-offs and the majority of women go on to have successful pregnancies in the future. Being told that these events are very common can seem little consolation at the time, but try to keep positive, embrace the support, and when you and your partner feel emotionally and physically ready, get those sperm swimming again. How long is a pregnancy? Now let's get back to the mini you now safely nestled in your partner's uterus. Pregnancy is all about the timeline, and it's worth even the most disorganised dad getting his head around this at an early stage. The 9 months of pregnancy so often talked about is really 40 weeks of gestation, which the more mathematically minded will realise isn't really 9 months at all. The pregnancy timeline is traditionally broken down into three parts, episodes or seasons, known as trimesters. The first trimester takes you up to week 13, the second runs from week 14 to 27, and the third from week 28 to the big delivery day itself. And while 40 weeks is the magic number, remember that it's completely normal for a woman to give birth at any time between week 37 and 42 and have what's known as a term baby. This is a baby that, as far as us medical types are concerned, is born at a normal and safe time, and all being well, would be expected to survive without medical assistance in the big wide world. Obviously, they will need some help though, so don't stop listening just yet. As the months stretch out before you, you'll probably be frantically trying to calculate when your baby is due to arrive. Now here's a calculation nobody covered in the maths class. Pregnancy lasts 40 weeks, but from when? You might be pretty sure of the night, day, or even lazy afternoon that mummy met daddy and conception occurred. But even if you log your sex schedule on your smartphone calendar, you're unlikely to be able to work out the exact day of conception. This is because sperm can survive for up to 7 days once they've made their way into the friendly female reproductive tract. And even if your partner has her day of ovulation tattooed onto her, an egg can also survive at least a day before conception occurs. So, to make the calculation a little easier, the estimated delivery date, or EDD, is calculated as 40 weeks from the first day of your partner's last period. And the key is in the E. This is very much an estimate. Some women, particularly those with irregular periods, will struggle to calculate the exact date. A baby's birth is not like a microwave that's suddenly going to start beeping and fling the door open as soon as the set time is reached. Babies have a habit of arriving when they're ready, but the EDD is at least a rough guide that helps with all the planning that lies ahead. Sorry, but it's all we can offer at the moment. If you're currently scrolling through your calendar and losing count, a shortcut formula might help. Identify the first day of the last period, go back 3 months, then add on 7 days, and you get the due date. Alternatively, make life really easy and use one of the many EDD calculators available online. Staying healthy really helps. Whenever I first meet a woman who's just discovered she's pregnant, the conversation inevitably turns to what she should and shouldn't be doing to protect her unborn baby's health as the trimesters meander by. It's hard not to sound like a nutritionist life coach when dispensing advice to dads-to-be too, but the essence is pretty simple. Keeping your partner healthy will also keep your baby healthy. Your partner should avoid all of the things we secretly already know are bad for us, but there are a few pregnancy extras. But before she starts giving things up, there are two things to add in straight away. Folic acid supplements protect against neural tube defects, such as spina bifida, and should be ideally started 12 weeks prior to conception and continued until at least the 12th week of pregnancy. Most women will need to take 400 micrograms of folic acid each day, but women who are overweight, with a BMI over 30, or suffer from diabetes or celiac disease, or who are on certain epilepsy medications, will need a higher dose, so need to seek specialist advice. A daily supplement of vitamin D is also recommended for all pregnant and breastfeeding women. Handily, plenty of companies have combined these two supplements into a daily pregnancy pill. One thing that has to go, without a doubt, is smoking. Everybody's agreed that smoking causes significant harm to both mum and baby, and increases the risk of ectopic pregnancy, miscarriage, and stillbirth. If your partner's a smoker, the healthcare team will offer extensive support to help her give up, and normally undertake carbon monoxide breath testing, it's a bit like an alcohol breathalyzer, to confirm that she's stopped. Kicking the habit can be tricky, but there's never been a better excuse, and people are 3 times more likely to give up smoking with support from a professional and some form of nicotine replacement therapy. So embrace the gum, patches and lozenges, all of which are safe in pregnancy. Even if your partner doesn't smoke, being around people who smoke is harmful to your baby. So if you or anybody else you live with is still puffing away, now's the time to get responsible and kick the habit too, for the sake of your unborn child. Passive smoking is linked to stillbirth and sudden infant death syndrome. SIDS, or cot death, as well as hampering baby's growth and health. And no, before you ask, having a cheeky fag out of the window isn't going to solve the problem, I'm afraid. Traces of toxic chemicals on clothes and around the home environment are where all the problems begin. Hard as it might be, smoking has to go. Alcohol is always a subject of much debate. Many an expectant dad panics that his partner has been drinking alcohol before she knew she was pregnant. This is a waste of time. Firstly, there's nothing you can now do to remove those glasses of wine or even the bottle of Prosecco knocked back at the office party. And secondly, it's unlikely to have caused any significant problems. That said, once you know she's pregnant, the official advice is that your partner should avoid all alcohol throughout pregnancy. Drinking alcohol, especially during the first trimester, can increase the risk of miscarriage and premature birth, and excessive intake can lead to fetal alcohol syndrome. Some pregnant women do choose to have the occasional alcoholic drink, but keeping intake to a minimum is important. Although eating for two isn't a thing, it's worth helping your partner out with some of the do's and don'ts of healthy eating for pregnancy lifestyle. Healthy mum equals healthy baby. There are some foods that should be avoided altogether, as they carry a higher risk of infection that may either upset mum or potentially cause damage to your unborn baby. Let's begin with cheese. The first rule is no cheese made with unpasteurised milk. Beyond that, hard cheeses are all good. Mould-ripened, stinky soft cheeses like brie, camembert, blue cheese and some goat's cheeses have a small risk of infecting mum and baby with listeria, an infection known as listeriosis that can cause birth defects or miscarriage. But cheese lovers, relax. The risk is massively reduced if the cheese is cooked. So, bake a camembert, pop the blue cheese on a pizza, or grill some goat's cheese and whack it in a salad. Soft processed cheeses like mozzarella, feta, and ricotta, made from pasteurised milk, are perfectly safe. I'm a doctor, not a chef, but a little bit of culinary genius can suddenly make the pregnancy restrictions look a whole lot less bleak. While we're in the kitchen, raw or uncooked meats carry the risk of infection with toxoplasmosis, a parasite also found in cat poo and unpasteurised goat's milk. Not even a chef could successfully combine these two ingredients into an attractive menu option. So cook meat thoroughly, and if your partner's desperate for a platter of uncooked or cured meats, like salami or prosciutto, either freeze them for 4 days to kill those nasty parasites, or scatter them over that pizza you've already covered with stinking ripe cheese and pop it in the oven. On the subject of freezing, restrictions have now relaxed about eating raw fish. Sushi lovers can still indulge as long as the fish has been frozen beforehand. However, a pregnant woman should avoid shark, swordfish, or marlin, as they contain high levels of mercury that may damage baby's nervous system. She should also not eat more than 2 tuna steaks per week or 4 medium-sized cans of tinned tuna because of its mercury levels. The advice is to avoid excess oily fish too. That's things like salmon, mackerel, herring and trout. Keep to no more than 2 portions a week. Finally, while we're getting nuts in the food cupboard, we'd best talk about peanuts. There's currently no evidence that eating peanuts during pregnancy increases the risk of peanut allergy in children. So despite what you might hear, if she loves peanuts, who are we to argue? We hadn't been trying for a baby for long when a few night shifts got in the way of what my wife considered to be proper trying. There's nothing quite like a night on call to kill the libido. A combination of apps, ovulation detectors, and abandoned contraception meant that my wife, a self-professed non-scientist, was now behaving like a professor of fertility medicine. As the usual period date approached, excitement soared. Could this be it? Had we done it at the first attempt? The message came through at work the following day, accompanied by a string of sad-faced emojis. The period had come. And no, we weren't quite the fertile superhumans we'd somehow hoped we might be. There was a definite criticism of my sperm, probably their fault, and a school report-style feedback note of must try harder. So, sparing you the further specific details, it wasn't long before there really was no period. A week passed, and still nothing. After 2 weeks, the temptation to test became unbearable. So, with a new job about to start the following day, we bought the pregnancy test kits and off she went to do the business. I'd previously laughed at those ridiculous TV adverts for pregnancy test kits, where a delighted woman with tears of joy in her eyes comes out of the bathroom, brandishing a wee-soaked stick with two little blue positive lines on. But suddenly, here I was, confronted by exactly that. A sense of disbelief, a desire to buy all the kits and test again and again. The joy of success and the fear of not being up to the job of dad. In that instant, I went from a doctor with all the theoretical knowledge of pregnancy, birth and parenting to a dad-to-be with the realisation that I lacked all the practical experience of what it truly meant to be a father. It turns out the flood of emotions I felt in that moment was not unusual. Despite this being a planned pregnancy, I couldn't stop questioning whether now was really the right time. Were we really up to the job, and how much would our lives have to change? All of this was superficial worry, though, compared to the underlying warm glow that was flowing through my veins. An amazing sense of pride and joy. I was going to be a dad, and, ready or not, this baby was coming for me. I vowed there and then to embrace and enjoy whatever journey lay ahead. For another dad-to-be, things weren't going quite so smoothly. The delight of a positive pregnancy test was followed by an evening spent in the local emergency department, with his partner having cramping pains and vaginal bleeding. The doctors felt it wasn't an ectopic pregnancy, but warned it may be the signs of miscarriage, and asked them to return the following day for a scan. He described his horror as the lovely nurse performing the scan raised a dildo-style ultrasound probe and covered it with what appeared to be a condom, before adding a bit of lubrication and inserting it into his partner's vagina. The scan was painless for his partner, but for both of them, the wait seemed interminable. Within seconds, however, uninterpretable images were appearing on the nearby monitor, and it wasn't long before they were reassured that a live, viable pregnancy was seen, along with a fetal heartbeat. The sense of relief in the room was immense. It was a first look into the anxieties parenthood can bring, and a stark reminder that dads-to-be are going to need to get used to things becoming a bit clinical in the vagina department. Not spreading the news. Trying to keep the exciting pregnancy news from friends and family for the first few weeks was far more difficult than I'd ever imagined, mainly because of my difficulty in keeping a poker face and the sudden onslaught of events where my wife would normally have been drinking alcohol. I soon became the master of a solo visit to the bar to secretly request drinks that would pass for alcohol but not cause any damage to the bundle of cells now growing at an alarming rate inside the uterus. Soda water dressed up as gin and tonic does the trick perfectly. My wife turned down several invitations to events where she thought friends might guess what was going on, but started to feel a bit isolated by the secret. Eating out suddenly became a challenge too. Why was she suddenly so against goat's cheese? And what was our newfound interrogation of waiters at sushi restaurants all about? Traditionally, couples wait until the 12-week dating scan before announcing their news, but it's got to be a personal decision that's right for you. Another dad told me he didn't see the point in waiting to tell people. Well aware that things could go wrong in the early days, he and his partner had decided that even if they did have problems, they'd want the support of their nearest and dearest. So why not involve them from the outset? Whichever way you go, choose carefully who you decide to share this early news with. And, if you're taking the secret approach, support your partner through the difficult months as your friends and family wonder why you've gone slightly under the radar or developed some crazy new lifestyle habits. In reality, they'll probably be on to you. So, all-out denial seems to be a pretty good policy to adopt too.
What women want. Do. Be strong, supportive, and don't panic. It's amazing and terrifying at the same time for both of you. Don't run through every alcoholic drink or piece of cheese your partner consumed in the last month before the positive pregnancy test and panic about the potential damage done.
Chapter 3. Brain. Mind, midwives, and the first trimester. From the doctor. As the first trimester gets underway, pregnancy hormones are racing through the body. Surging blood levels of estrogen and progesterone are often accompanied by mood change and a roller coaster of emotions. Most women notice the psychological impact of these changes between weeks 6 and 10 of pregnancy, and often even surprise themselves at how dramatic and unprovoked their mood swings can be. The good news is that things normally settle down as the friendly second trimester approaches, so hold tight and quietly remember that it's probably just the hormones and their effect on the brain's neurotransmitters that are causing what can seem like irrational behaviour.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.